Okay, I mean, this is a public political space. And my name is Heikki Patomäki, and I will give an opening remark on as one of the chairs of the ALTA Finland. This is a public political space. A space comes into being whenever people gather together to discuss issues of common concern, like this. So the point of this seminar is to discuss the current problems and the future prospects of the European Union in a language that is easily understandable across the European Union. It's also going to be taped and later broadcast in the internet, so it can be followed also elsewhere. And one of the points is, of course, that the public sphere of the European Union, if there is any, is also here in Helsinki. Not only in Brussels or Paris or London or Berlin. Now, I will make two arguments, and they both concern a turning point. The first is that the integration process of the European Union itself is in a turning point, in terms of its own logic. And the second concerns its economic, ideological underpinnings, namely the logic of neoliberalism and neoliberalization. I think that the idea of deepening market and political discipline, which is premised on the neoclassical economic theory or orthodoxy, has come to a turning point as well. And I will try to explain briefly how. The whole point and the rationale of the European Union, why do we have such an entity as the European Union in place, is that the whole, namely Europe, is more than the sum of its parts, namely the national states. So there's a reason why we should have a system of common governance, right? Now, and this has been the justification of the European Union. There are interdependencies, things are interconnected in Europe and also elsewhere. So we do need, and we have established systems of governance. And this is symbolized by the role of the Commission in the European Union. The task of the members of the Commission, their duty is to seek out the means to express the common good of all citizens, interests and states together. So, and in order to do this, there's a further idea, namely to avoid anything that would have to do with expressing political prejudices or convictions. So, in other words, there's a technocratic rule in the European Union in the name and in the interest of the common good. And my argument here is that this logic can only be applicable or can only work to a certain point, and we have reached that point now. For one thing, I mean, the question is always, I mean, who is the one who defines what the common good is? Democratic politics understood in terms of res publica, matters of common concern, which means also in terms of contestation over all those issues that are thought to belong to the public will and to be also in the common good. That politics revolves around actually defining what the common good is. So there are of course occasions, like in diplomatic negotiations after the Second World War, in a conflictual situation or in some other areas as well, there might be a case to be made for some sort of agreements that appear to be neutral in political terms, or merely technical, or in any case, I mean, whatever the precise logic and whatever the precise vocabulary, the idea is to decontest these issues. There are certain contexts when this might make sense. However, the more powers the European Union institutions assume, the less there's a basis for thinking about politics in the European Union in this way. In other words, the more there are powers, or more powers lie in the EU institutions, the more the legitimization of the European Union must be based on generalizable normative principles and democratic procedures. And democratic procedures, I take to be mean not only certain decision-making procedures, but also procedures and ways of publicly forming political will, which means that you have to have a public sphere in existence as well. Now, already the Maastricht Treaty, in my reading, went way beyond the threshold between issues that are or can be justifiably seen as merely technical. instead of being in fact political or deeply political. But now the new attempts at budgetary control over the member states of the European Union, in fact, and other forms of control in terms of matters of common concern, mean that the EU is approaching a point where it is increasingly, in fact, replacing national democracy in terms of European technocracy. And I think this is really a turning point. There's a choice to be made between openly democratic politics in Europe, on the one hand, and between a de facto technocratic one-party system, with merely symbolic multi-party elections in the member states. And this is already happening in some of the crisis countries in a very clear way, but these new treaties now under discussion would take this logic quite far with regard to all member states. So no disagreements over economic policy would be allowed for any member state anymore. That is, that would mean the abolition of democratic politics in Europe. The second problem has to do with the economic side of things. With the deepening market and political discipline premised on the neoclassical economic theory and ideology. The argument being that this logic is actually counterproductive. The purpose of all these principles of the economic and monetary union, common currency, and strategies of competitiveness is to stimulate economic growth and also to strengthen the position of the European Union in the world economy. That's the point. However, from a post-Keynesian economic theoretical perspective, exactly the opposite is to be expected. The prevailing neoliberal economic policies favor the process of financialization, but at the same time tend to curtail effective demand in the European political economy, and moreover eliminate a number of important instruments of economic policy as well. Now, there are always, in any capitalist market society and economy, there are always various imbalances and uneven developments. Very often they're accumulative in nature, very often they tend to be self-reinforcing as well. Now, in this kind of situation, when we rely only on the so-called market forces, the situation is very often vulnerable to various shocks and crises. And this applies to the EMU as well. The EMU construction is weak and vulnerable to external shocks. And the argument is therefore that in the absence of adequate political mechanisms and effective instruments in the European Union as a whole, at the EU level, the Euro project is in fact contradictory. It's contradictory because there's an attempt to create a monetary union without a political union. And it doesn't work. And if you look at the experiences of 10 years of Euro, the economic developments have been far from impressive. Quite to the contrary, in fact. Europe is no more prosperous than it was 10 years ago. One could argue that exactly the opposite is the case. A lot of social and cultural capital has been lost due to these kinds of reforms. And no even GDP measure wealth has been created, or very little. And there have been rising inequalities in Europe at the same time. And some parts of Europe are in the process of collapse. But one would generalize this point. I mean, even though some of these contradictions are perhaps more clearly visible inside the European Union than elsewhere, in fact, what seems to be happening is that the structural contradictions of the neoliberalized world economy as a whole are actually played out inside the European Union in a particularly problematical way. And the Euro crisis is thus, in this reading, is not just a European crisis. It's in fact a crisis of the governance of the world economy as a whole. With Europe, the dollar is in crisis, and in fact this crisis was instigated by the financial collapse of 2008 and 2009. So, One could say that from the point of view of the world economy as a whole, there's a choice between either a vicious debt deflation circle or a reconstitution of the European Union on a new basis. And I would argue that the latter can only be done in terms of some sort of global political economy reforms as well. The fate of the European Union is intertwined with that of the global political economy as a whole. So the regeneration of the European project seems to be tied with the success of reforms of the systems of global governance as well. And these are some of the things that we are also going to discuss in the panel itself. Thank you.